Hey everyone, today we're talking about a really hot topic, which is water. Water on the farm, water on the small scale farm, water to grow vegetables, organic vegetables. And because of climate change, things have changed. Like, I remember when I started, farming 20 years ago, you know, most vegetable growers here in Quebec, they didn't even have an irrigation system. They would the rain would supply all the water that was needed on a weekly basis, and everything was fine. And over my years, like, we've definitely seen the climate warm up. Like, we start at least 4 weeks earlier than before. The frost dates have moved. It's getting warmer sooner and sooner in the winter. But one of the obvious things that is happening right now, it's not just that the climate is warming up, is that we're getting these events, these heavy rainfalls, these flooding, these droughts. So we're getting these extreme events, and that's taking a toll on the farm. And so today I just want to go over with you some of the strategies that we've put in place here at La Grelinette. Hopefully this can be helpful for you all. This is a great season, I have to say. Like, this is probably our best season that we've had weather-wise in many, many moons. We've been having consistent rain, really nice rain, really warm weather. Things are growing. Now we feel like this is the tropic. So this is great. But the last few years haven't been like that. So I have a lot to share about that. So we're going to the pond. I'll show you the pond, but we have friends in Vermont, which is like 2 miles from here. And man, they've been hit hard with flash flood events. Like, we've seen images of so many farms that are flooded, heavily flooded with like many, many feet of water. So it's like, there's so many things to think about when we're designing a farm. Like, it's the first step, like designing the farm. The best advice that I've always given to all the growers that I've helped through the years is make sure that you have a slope. Make sure that the farm is somehow on a slope. It doesn't need to be a big slope, but you always need to think in terms of when we're designing the farm, where the beds will go, where the field blocks, like how they'll be sloped. And the trick, and that's really important, is to really make sure that there's always a slope so that in the case that there's a flash flood, heavy, heavy rainfall, the water can get channeled away from the growing area. That's also why we raise our beds. A few inch, the beds are raised, and that makes the whole difference when there's a heavy rainfall event, because the water will just kind of, they'll hit the ground, the moisture will get in, but the excess water will flow out and then go into the pathways. And then if the beds and the field blocks are made on a slope, a tiny slope, you know, the excess water gets channeled away. And moving forward, like, this is what we've done here, and we've been really, you know, happy. Everything is on contour, is on a slope. And the next step for that, and that's something that we didn't do here because, you know, that wasn't the reality 20 years ago, is to slope the farm so that all that excess water gets pooled in the same place, even with drainage tiles, whatever, so that we can get that excess water and keep it for when we don't have enough water. That's really the key here. So this is like, this at the farm here at La Grelinette, it works super well because we have ditches on the side, and it brings the water outside. But we need to recollect it. That would be the next step to our pond. That would be probably an excavator that would come in, create some tiles, drainage tiles for the excess overflow water, and then the water would go 200-300 feet further out into the pond in the forest. I'll show you. This for me connects with the role of smaller farms, because doing this kind of land work on, you know, a farm that would be, you know, a mechanized farm, always keep in mind, like, a mechanized farm is like we're doing, you know, on 10 acres what we could be doing on 2 acres, because we're, you know, biointensive and super tight here. So you have just more land to manage and more land to landscape. So that's why I always refer back to the smaller market gardens and in smaller farms, like the work that needs to be done to set up an irrigation system, to do, you know, the groundwork, the work for catchment, the pond work, is on a smaller scale. And so in my opinion, it's more doable, it's more accessible, it's less expensive. It's less of a, you know, super big project. Doing land work on 10 acres is like, it's a lot of money. We're in the forest now, and you were saying that it feels, you know, it's cooler. And it's like really simple, like anything that has to do with climate change and the fact that the earth is warming up, like the only solution to climate change is to have canopy, like to have forests that are planted, because like honestly, like it's a couple of degrees less and you really feel great when you're in the forest. So I think like a big part of the problem is that we've cleared all the forests. So we're never in an environment where we're sheltered by the sun and then there's moisture everywhere because of the plants. So honestly, friends, like we should be thinking about this. Like when we're talking about climate change, we should be planting trees and hopefully have enough time for these trees to get big and create these canopies. That's my theory about that. But now we're getting to the pond. And we did a video, Chris and I, about the pond here. We had to redig it a few times. You can check out that video if you guys want to learn more about how we did it and the story. But this is probably the equivalent of a 40 feet by 100 foot long pond. It's about 10 feet deep. And this year, again, we've had so much nice rainfalls that it's been filled. We don't really need to water that much in the field. And because it rains a lot, it's still pretty full. But that's really where we capture all our water. And there's not much more to say about it, except that when it's full of water, it creates a really nice habitat for a lot of amphibians, frogs. You can hear them at night. It's so loud here that it's hard to sleep. Creating these ponds also is really helpful because it's adding biodiversity to the farm, which I think is also key when we're talking about climate smart farming. We got into farming because we love nature and we studied ecology, and it's all linked, it's all connected. So creating a space, a pond here to water our crops, but we're also creating this habitat. And it's not just a habitat for nature, it's a habitat for us. You see there's a sauna there. That was the first building that I built. That's like 20 years ago. So the sauna there, it's a hangout space. And it's just like, I feel that this is a place that Modelene and I, we've crafted this place. Like, you know, we've built this, we've managed it, and just we've became the steward of this small piece of land. And I think that's really the connection there between farming, ecology, lifestyle, and our role in rewilding the world, which is really, really what this is all about. Like, so having the opportunity to grow crop for a living, to be a farmer, allows us to do this. And I think that's the most precious part, the gift. And I've said this to you, Chris, in different interviews, like the more I realize that this, we spend time like on the farm and like working with soil, like it's like I used to think that it would be, you know, we're changing the world and we're healing the world, but I really come to realize now that it's nature that's healing us. And that's the gift that we've had, Modelene and I, and that we've been, you know, hopefully passing on to others. But man, it's all connected. It's all connected. So in a nutshell, like, I don't have any grand theory to say, except that, you know, managing water is the next big thing in farming for sure. And I'm just hopeful that extension agents and just like there's going to be help for to fund these projects so that the farms can be well better designed, catchment, release, irrigation systems, putting more drip irrigation. I used to say drip irritation because it was, you know, it's much more work, but now I realize that it's, you know, in places where water is short, you know, you don't really have a chance. Water on clocks, irrigation, like measuring moisture carefully. And for me, that's the next frontier. And the new farmers now that are starting, they should really, really be mindful when they do the design of their farms, of how the water flows. And the best way to do this is when there's a heavy rainfall, you walk the fields and you just follow the trail of the water. That tells the story of the farm, of the field. So just follow the trail of the water and see where it goes, where it pools. Put flags. If it pools in an area all the time and it's always kind of wet, that's where the pond needs to be. So just like having a lecture of the land, and again, keeping the farm small, in my opinion, is the best way to achieve, you know, all of this faster. And that's the message that I've been saying for all these years. So I'll catch you in the next episode. And again, if you want to learn more about the pond, you can check out this video. And if you want to learn more about the work that we do at the Market Gardener Institute, you can subscribe to the post, check out our newsletter, make sure that we're connected, and I hope you guys are doing well. Okay, I am. JM out.